Let's go and have a look at the course with about a minute and 20 seconds to go. And what's the start line looking like?
Start line is 300 metres, port side advantage of 30 metres. Wind has shifted 20 degrees right in the last 2 minutes.
So which way would you go, Evie?
Well, at the moment, the thing is, now the wind is shifting right, but we know from the conditions that we've been seeing today that it's shifting right to left and back. So you can start at the comity boat, but you know that at one point it's going to go back to that left side. So start right.
If it's, I'm looking at those pictures and...
it's only just port side bias at the moment, so only just pin in at the moment.
Oh, it shifted, yeah.
And it's only the poles at this end of the line.
Looks like it just looks pressure down, but remember, what you see on screen's a lot less than it really is. Wow, these poles are going for it. What are they doing here? This is an aggressive starting. They're going for a port hand start.
I think so. It's a 20-metre bias at the moment.
Winners of the last race, the Norwegians stuck right in the middle of the fleets, in the middle of the line. And we'll keep an eye on the poles as the clock counts down.
That's never going to work. That's never going to work. How can they not see
and they've
that?
Pretty much stalled on the start line. A good start for the Japanese. And they're all clear, so a clean start for the whole fleet with, again...
The Swedes
out in front.
We should just say it now before it even happens.
Yeah. Well, the pin had definitely looked better. 35-meter advantage.
It just knocked on port. So it's just gone left. The wind's just gone left as they started. And you can see the fleet's pointing. It's definitely knocking there or heading.
And with that, I've just seen the Japanese jump up the leaderboard into the lead. Obviously, very early days, that's probably going to change. But right now, it's Harada and Nagamatsu who are in front.
But if it's such a big header, they might consider
they should tack.
Taking that the gains that they've made so far and
across
the fleet. I agree.
We'll see if they do that. Wester and Netzler are the Swedes in second. Singaporeans in the mix as well. Singaporeans having a good day of racing so far. These are our leaders.
I'd want to be getting back to the middle before it goes back the other way. I really would. They could have crossed the fleet. Let's see how that lasts, because if the wind goes back the other way, watch where those Japanese just drop down out of this.
But it was just in your vision. There is a black area, and it's hitting them right now. So that's maybe the reason why they're continuing. I mean, we can see on the analytics what's happening right now, but we can't actually see the wind pressure coming, and they can on the water. So that's maybe the reason why they're continuing at this point.
It's still working for them. So the fleet, everyone was looking at them. So, you know, and that's what you've... You can sail these. Well, look at that line.
Yeah.
That, there's a few different ones going through there. That gives you some real idea of the difficulty of this course. You can sail without a compass. You don't need a compass to sail racing. All you need to do is sail off the fleet and just look at how you align off them. Do you sail with a compass, Evie, or not?
Yeah, definitely.
You do?
Yeah.
Do you remember a guy called Glenn Burke?
No, but I'm sure you do.
I think three
Tell
times.
Tell us something about him.
Three-time world laser champion, won a skip of the America's Cup.
It's a shame that I don't know him.
Your point?
Yeah.
He never sailed with a compass. And he was dominant. And, you know, he's won world championships in many classes. And he just talked about sailing this fleet.
So Yoko Harada and Sarah Nagamatsu. Real experience does Harada have. 30 years old and one of the top FX crews from Japan. There are three of them in this class here in Aarhus, all of them competing to prove themselves for a spot in Tokyo in 2020. And right now they're doing the business, and they've had some good racing all day. They've been in the top 20, and now they're trying to hold on to the lead, but being challenged by the French, Bossard and Compagne.
Yeah, that's probably... Bossard and Compagne are not really the ones to worry about. Now they've tacked, now they'll be something to consider. But The Japanese, as Evie said, they hung out there. Look, they found that little pressure line, and it looks like they're going to get across, doesn't it? This right-hand side is starting to lift, though, in the bar karate stakes, as Evie is giving me the signal. It looks to her that the right-hand, the group out to the right, are carrying a big lift on port at the moment. Which...
She's lost her cap. It's flying behind her, strapped onto her her kit. Maybe that's what they use for wind direction.
The cap? Well, actually... I always had a cap like that, and when I was sailing on the downwinds, I used to feel the wind on my ears. Mm. And you can actually feel the wind changing by the feeling on your ears. Wow. So it's actually a nice trick to know where the wind is coming from.
So we've got the poles in the left corner, and we've got... So I just want to see what the corners do. And we've got Schmidt and Schmidt, the Denmark team, in the right corner at the moment. So I'll be intrigued to see how they go. See which one of them comes out looking the most famous. The poles are currently leading according to the analytics.
Yeah, but it's all so close that this is going to chop and change. The Japanese in there, so too are the French, Bossard and Compan. There's a German team in there as well. So it's all very close indeed. It's going to be interesting when they come into this top mark for the first time.
The wind's sitting at 280.
Yeah, so it might shift back to the right, and if that happens, that pack on the right is going to pop out, I think.
Yeah, I'm just waiting. So there's here we go. Could this be the sign of a little shift? So it's gone further left into the 280s, and now it's trying to come back.
Here's a good look at the poles on the left-hand side of the course.
Left is going to be... I think middle left is going to be favoured at the moment. That's probably the spot to be sitting. Who's sitting middle left at the moment? Is that the Japanese? I reckon that's where they are. So they went back at the right time. I think the Japanese are going to look pretty good. Here's a right shift. I'm just looking at the bot up the course. You can see the wind bot just up the course there. And you can see the angle that it's got. It's just going right up the course. So the Japanese might be far enough forward to be okay, but there's going to be a group out to the right. We'll just have a look. We're making a bit of a guess off the wind bot. That's gone back on your screen, hasn't it?
I hope we are looking at the same screen.
Japanese out in front there. Good shot of them, and a good shot of Bossard and Compan, the French, all of which are challenging for that first place.
Yeah,
also in the mix here. The
Swedes.
Like a real long port tack. It's been a while since the wind has shifted.
Yeah.
It usually shifts a couple of times during the upwind, and we haven't seen that quite this upwind.
The Swedes in the middle, they're in the middle right at the moment, and they're just getting knocked now. So the Swedes
shifting, yeah.
Yep. This would be good. We're going to have a good battle here, so I'm not sure the answer.
It's close racing. Like, everybody's really packed.
They'd be pretty happy, though, the Japanese. They came back at the right time. They did what Evie told them to do, look for that little bit of pressure just out there. And then,
yeah, they're actually looking quite good.
And they're
lifting. Looks like a new lefty coming in.
Yeah.
Well, the front of the fleet, just about 40 metres separating something like 15 boats.
I tell you who's coming. Look out for our Danish friends.
Are they making a charge?
Just keep your eye out. I reckon they're going to come through.
I think we can. We might be able to. We'll see them soon. Hansen and Salskov Iversen of Denmark,
yep,
making a charge up the fleet.
They're in that left group coming. They're coming out of the left. They're in that front part of that left group, so they're nicely placed in the middle of the course, in very smart tactical position. So the Japanese did the right thing. They hung on probably, as Evie said, they saw that wind and hung on just long enough.
Yeah, and you can see they're really in the darker area. The water is a little bit darker colored, and it means that they have a little bit more pressure. With more pressure usually comes also a little bit higher mode.
Just come back to the left too. Yeah. So they've done it really well. They obviously saw something we couldn't see from here, but you could see. Here we go.
It's all really left favored. It's the first time actually today that we can actually see that the side has paid off.
Yeah. Yeah, and there's a whole bunch of people coming out of that left side that are going to look really good.
So the Japanese out in front, but not by much. French in second. Singaporeans around. Singaporeans coming up to the mark. Apologies.
And we can tell by the crowd.
The Danish swinging by. A lot of.
Oh, look at this. Big Lull just got caught them out. They've dipped a wing and got overtaken. So
battle between the Italians and the Spanish. And Omari and Di Stefano struggling to get around that top mark. Here come the Argentinians and speeding past them are the Czechs.
There's a big lull. There's sort of a hole just hit that mark. That's what happened. People are dipping their wings and getting slowed down.
Well, it didn't hit the whole area, did it? Because the Argentinians saw the Czechs fly past.
Yeah. It's like one of those little wind bombs that drop out of the cloud that Matt was talking about before.
So really busy fleet at the back here. The Dutch, the Germans, Kiwis in the mix. That's Maloney and Meech.
So the wind was in the left as we went around that top mark, so all the fleet doing a bear away and charging down, riding kites on the starboard jibe.
Yeah, so we started off at 305 and we ended at 275.
Big so movement. That's
big,
a lot.
Big lefty. Yeah, that's 30 degrees.
And as they head downwind, we're beginning to see the leaders gain a bit of separation between the boats. Harada, Nagamatsu out in front. Bossart and Compound doing their best to keep that gap to round about 10 metres. And then come the Danes in third place, Hansen and Salskov Iversen. Looks like another good race from them if they can hold on, if they don't get caught out by these strange, weird wind shifts.
Well, they're all on the same jibe, all going in the same direction at the moment, so not many passing lanes when that happens. Some of them are sailing high, some are sailing low, so that's about the only difference that's going on in the fleet. The angle that they've decided to take. Good view out the window, actually, guys. If you actually look, you can see it quite clearly.
That's a beautiful scene. All those coloured sails heading from left to right from the shore.
You can see the pressure lines down there. There's good pressure about to hit the bottom end of the course, too, by the looks of it.
The sun glinting off the sails. It's a magnificent view. And some magnificent boats out there as well. And spectators have come out in their droves. Four sailing clubs in Aarhus alone. And so a really knowledgeable audience, set of fans here on the dockside watching.
Yeah, that was nice.
They're quick.
Yeah,
manoeuvre again. Do it perfectly.
Nothing shaked in the boat at all, did it? It just rolled through smoothly. It was really, really, really nice. And look at the speed they've got going. That looks fantastic. Right back in the foot straps.
16 and a half knots right now from the Danes.
Ponytails flying off the back there. That just looks super cool.
Going 2 knots faster than the boats around them.
The Danes have just taken the lead. So they are set up perfectly.
That is a great shot for us. You can see all the little black bullets screaming down the course. That boat to windward of them is about to get a little pressure. Wow, what a great race. Been a fantastic day, I tell you. What a great recovery from the Danes, though. You know, you can mentally drop your bundle or you can just pick up and go, can't you? You can really...
It got them really fired up, that second race.
Yeah.
And
you don't get to be world champions and be mentally weak.
No.
So
they're all going to come to the left mark looking upwind, I reckon. That's what they're all aiming for at the moment. And the Danes have positioned themselves with buoy room.
Here is the gate. Now they're going to have to squeeze their way through. The Japanese get to it first.
Just missed it, just slightly.
Yeah, they had a right of way, the Japanese team, so they had to wait a little bit.
Oh, what's
but
going
a better,
on with the French
much
there?
Much better rounding.
How did the Japs have right of way?
Well, either way, the Japanese are away ahead of the Danes. An appreciative round of applause from the crowd here.
Mark-room.
And the French in third place. The Italians in the mix as well, Omari and Di Stefano.
Yeah, it's good to see. They've sailed quite well down that run.
And who's this? This is the Spanish taking a bath. Taking a little dip in the ocean. And heading off back upwind for the second time. Halfway through the race now, it's Japan, Denmark, France, Italy in fourth, and Spain in fifth.
I've got a feeling the wind is going to try and crank slightly more left. If I was heading upwind, I would be biasing slightly. As Evie said, we've never called a side before, but I'd be biasing left side just slightly at the moment.
It's down to 268 at the moment. So that's the most left that we've seen all day.
The later we get in the day, the more likely that is to happen. So there's got to be some sort of influence with the clouds burn off. But they're still there. There'll be no... I can't see any thermal effect. I think that's just the way the gradient's moving around as it clocks through the day.
There we go. Good view now of the leaders. Good idea of the distance between first, second and third. It's going to be an interesting battle for third as well, because the French and the Italians, there really is not much between them.
I do want to clarify, I wouldn't come all the way over to the left here. I'd be onto my port tack pretty quickly, because you've got to expect that wind will go
turn back
at some stage.
Yeah.
But I'd be starting on this left-hand side because it's the favoured side, and which is most of them have all done. Pressure dropping down a little bit there too, champ. We're just seeing a slight drop in pressure as we come here. So it's getting patchy. Have a look at that shot there. It's sort of getting patchy across the course.
Well, it's 4:30. You know, it's usual that it starts to get a little bit lighter by the end of the day.
Yeah. Well, come on. We've enjoyed a full afternoon of sailing. We've only got two legs to go. Yeah. The wind is not going to let us down now.
Yeah,
we're going to enjoy the end
blowing.
Of this race. As we head upwind, with the Japanese nominally in control of the Danes.
We're not talking about it disappearing and getting negative. We're talking about it from a tactical point of view, I think. Evie and I think we're both going through the idea of what gears would we change, how would we be setting up our boat. You know, you're probably on this thing, you might drop a little bit of Cunningham Eye off or downhaul off. You know, you might start thinking of those sorts of movements. Do you go higher on your trapeze? Weight going forward, you can see that. That's a classic example. And you see how much the boat just stopped bouncing there? Did you see that?
Yeah.
So that's a classic move. And the Danish team starting to look pretty classy right about now.
So Yoko Harada used to be a radial sailor. Did you ever compete against her? I think she switched to the FX in 2015. It is possible to do that and be successful, and she's certainly proving that here.
Didn't Charlotte Dobson do the same thing from the English?
There's a few of them.
Yeah, definitely. Charlotte was campaigning for 2012, and then
that's right. Yeah.
Switched to the 49er FX.
Yeah, that's right. She missed out in the lasers in 12, and then
yes.
So she got in 16. She got there in the 49ers. Yeah, that's right. That's right.
With the Danes, Jane Hansen, Katja Salskov-Iversen, in front of their home crowd.
Just showing up. Well, speaking of Charlotte Dobson and Saskia Tidy, they've just tacked out. They're on the right-hand side of that course. They're probably about eighth overall at the moment, so they've just tacked out and they're... Maybe I'm not sure what the wind's doing at the moment. Just trying to find out for us. Maybe crank back. It's not 268 anymore. It's probably 275, 276. So
yeah, no, it's actually at 285.
Oh, there you go.
Yeah, so it's swung right again.
That's
and they're
a
making
movement.
A huge gain there on the right side. Actually, they were in 16th position and at the moment in fifth.
Oh. So if you'd come off that bottom mark, off that left gate, roll onto port pretty quickly, you'd be back on the starboard right now and you'd probably be winning the world championship.
It's a little bit too early to think that way, I would say. But
again, Maloney and Meach showing their mettle, moving their way back up the fleet. And it's worth having another look at that. And you can see, just talk us through this sort of, when the wind drops out, down they go.
It's just all of a sudden... They come in an area where the wind is much lighter and all the power is going out of the sail, and you know, it just drops down, and they need to find the right balance again by moving their body in and then really responding to what the wind pressure is doing.
And it's exaggerated more on these boats because you're so much further out. The leverage, you've got so much more leverage.
And they need to be really quick to respond to that change.
So just talking about the New Zealanders there, they did exactly what we were just sort of joking about, you know, come off that bottom mark, go on to port fairly early and now back on starboard, and that's what has brought them back into this race. And the same, well, not quite the same, a little bit more extreme with Dobson and Tidy. They've gone a little bit further right and now they're picking up the benefit. So at the moment they may come back into this pretty well. Interesting where their next shift is. It looks like it's a pretty stable right-hander for a moment. As stable as a right-hander can go, it could.
And here are the Brits.
And so they went further right and they've been brought right back up, and they may even be up in the top couple of boats now just from that gain. And the good thing is for them, they've actually crossed in front of most of the fleet now, so the threat, you know, they can protect this position.
Yeah, all of them are going out towards the left ley line at the moment, so it's been right, but they're probably expecting it to go back left.
Yeah. And, I mean, if everyone's still heading that direction, why would you tack, you know? You just suddenly make yourself risky, so...
Yeah.
Here we go, so they're just why would you tack? So they're probably, yeah, there's a couple of boats starting to tack now, so that makes sense. So... the Danish team have tacked. Yeah, all our leaders have tacked. So they've all just basically fleet management there.
Yeah, definitely. And I think they're really close to that ley line, so it's just a matter of going in that last. Yeah,
you had to tack, didn't you?
Yeah.
Is it going back for you? Yeah, it's still right. It's even more right, to tell the honest truth. It's 294. So
but since there's nobody on that right side,
yeah,
it's actually not the way to go. But since everybody's there, they're not going to lose it.
Looks like they're having the same discussion themselves.
So yeah,
Charlotte Dobson on the back there, starting with her crew.
But what Evie's saying is, if the other boats are going that way, you need to get right. So if everyone else is going to be on that tack, you're not going to lose to them. So take the opportunity while it's there. So you know, and you're not necessarily going to gain. You're not necessarily going to lose. I'll be interested to see where the Japanese come through here on this, because I think that they are a little bit further left, so they're going to follow in. I think there's a Dutch team going to come in. So they were a little bit right, and they might start to come back into this.
But a good move from Dobson and Tidy. Seeing them move up the fleet, quite a performance. Charlotte Dobson, two Olympic campaigns in the radial to her name. So plenty of experience. Saskia Tidy also was in Rio. But these are our leaders, the Danes, with a pretty good lead over the British right now.
Not 900 kilometres odd, though.
No.
Okay. It was a little bit more stable, but to give you an idea, the wind has shifted from 260 to 305, so that's 45 degrees in the last 8 minutes.
That will change a fleet. You would have spotted that, though, wouldn't you, Evie? You would have been onto that one.
Oh, no. You know, I've done a lot of stupid things also. That's how you get the experience, you know, by doing all the things a million times wrong.
I agree with you there.
Well, look at the Kiwis. They've now moved up into third place. 14th at one position during the race.
That big shift, mate. That's one. It went against them. Remember it went against them that second week last time? When it went for them that second work the first time.
Here come the Danes into the top mark for the final time. The Brits right behind them, steaming into the mark. The Danes are in control. Calm and collected.
And a big round of applause.
You've got to
there
think.
They are.
I haven't checked it, but if the wind has gone that far right, you've got to think it's a jibe set, don't you? You're going to be straight to the mark.
Definitely.
That's what I'll be doing.
Saskia Tidy doing all the work at the mast there.
Did they do a barrel away there?
Yeah, now. That position, that third and fourth placed battle is unfolding in front of us, and it looks like it's the Kiwis that are going to have third place, just sneaking in on the inside. Now, how smoothly can they go? Oh, the Kiwis went round well, didn't they?
Great recovery. They were in 14th. They climbed their way up during the race, and now in third.
So Maloney and Meech third, just ahead of Kuurt and Maat of the Netherlands. And then in come the Spanish and the Italians and the French. Italians lost a bit of lost a few places on that upwind leg.
Didn't see a sea flag at all, did you? I was just looking to see if we missed a sea flag around that top mark to see if there's been a change of course to the bottom, but I doubt it. But
I didn't see it, or I didn't hear any sound.
I was looking for it. I mean,
we're at 3:10.
Yeah,
it's going further right now.
So if this is a persistent shift, you know, it lasts long enough for this whole run, it's that quick, then the bear away and it keeps going, then it's going to be a game. But it's right out on the extremities. So, you know, mathematically, you just have to back it in as still to be an oscillating shift. And so you would take the knock while you had it. Our Danish team are being smart enough to come across and just lock in the UK team, or the Dobson and Tidy. It will actually be close, but it should work out pretty well in front for the Danish team.
Yeah, I agree. So I figured it was a jibe set with the wind being so far in the right corner.
Had to be. I thought when I saw the English team keep going, I thought, oh, they'll go for about 20 to 50 metres.
And then jibe.
And jibe, get some separation. I'm guessing that we're going to see the Danish team do a jibe here.
I'm kind of amused by the description of them as the English team, one Scottish, one's Irish. So
oh,
careful,
sorry.
Careful what you
British
say.
British team, sorry.
They'll come and tell you what they think.
Yeah, that's because
after racing, if you carry on like that. Hansen and Salskov Everson out in front now. And they've got quite some distance between themselves and the Brits. And you'd think that one and two are going to remain as they are. But third place, I think, is still far from decided.
Yeah, it's a really close battle, actually.
Japanese are coming back into the fray. I just saw the Japanese speed just nudge 17 knots for about 2 seconds. They're steaming down this final leg.
That's awesome, isn't it?
But what a great day for the Danish pair, with a victory and then a recovery here after a disappointing second race.
So they've just jibed in on their angle to the bottom marker, to the finish. I was just going
to
say,
the finish just to the right of the screen on that shot.
No risk now, but there was a big pressure with a right-hand swing, it might push them below the line and bring the other guy in, but not looking at that now. They're pretty comfortable, so we can put down your glasses, basically. They might, so they're going to end up with another quite substantial lead, assuming they stay dry here on this job, which of course they will, because they're very talented.
Well, so much for any concerns that she might have had going off to do the Volvo Ocean race. She's come back in pretty good form, has Jana Hansen. And they've been out practicing. And the practice and the training has already begun to show as the Danish pair claim their second victory of the day. And the home fans love that. Now, Dobson and Tidy about to register Great Britain's best position of the day in the FX. A second place finish for the pair. And then we can look back at third place. So, the Japanese, now the Kiwi seem to have dropped out of the running. They were third at that top mark. But right now, the Japanese seem to be holding that position. And just look how close it is coming into the finish line. Dutch boat in there as well. That's Kuurt and Mark. But here come the Japanese closest to the camera. Now we'll get our bearings when we see the gates. That's the bottom gate. So it's just a few metres to the finish line. And the Japanese have it. Arada and Nagamatsu, who led for much of the early stages of the race, have come back after a bit of a wobble, have come back to claim third place. Here come Kuvert and Mark, the Dutch pair. And it's still not decided for Maloney and the French of Bossard and Compan. Well, the data, the computers are giving it to the Dutch ahead of the Kiwis in fifth. French in sixth. And the Spanish, Suarez and Van der Velden, in seventh place.
Oh, look at that. That'd have cost yourself two places on the finish line.
Yeah, the Italians, who were threatening a top five finish, out of the running in the end, coming in 10th. But as we've said before, you know, in these early qualifying stages, every position you can make up the fleet is going to count as the week unfolds. When you've got 28 races ahead of you, and you look back and you think, crikey, I could have made the medal race if I'd only finished one place further up, you know, in race two or three. Must be very galling indeed. You don't want to be going home thinking that. There we go, the Singaporeans across the line.
It does strike me that this blue fleet, we had a lot more volatility in the results, more up and down in the results through the afternoon. So we're still charging down as we come through this fleet. We've got a couple more boats left come in. With the Estonian crew in 19th place, just going across the line there. And then a Finnish team of chasing 20th place. So they've had a pretty consistent result as they go through. And then we're going to move on as they start to come through here down to this finish. Still charging down, we've got the Polish crew coming in, an Argentinian team, and the two Swedish teams who didn't have the world's greatest result. We saw them come off that start line, working on that plan. So those two Swedish teams that you see coming in were, I guess, didn't quite get it right in the end, unfortunately for them. Very big day at the office. So three races is quite challenging for the sailors. A lot of work to be done. So they're feeling the physicality of it, which is what we've talked about a little bit during the day, would be quite intense. You can see now that Frank and Abicht, the Austrian team, is the boat coming here with the orange spinnaker charging down. I would say that we did hear from Martin Grau before saying that the day was fun out there, and I'd suggest that these ladies would be having the exact same thought. Regardless of how you do in the race, you're still out there having a great day sailing. You know, if you can keep everything in perspective, they would likely feel that. So the Austrian team now coming across the line, they had a pretty consistent day. They stayed in that sort of mid-20s range throughout the day. Then I think we've got the Polish team, I think that is, just starting to come into shot. And then another Japanese team heading across the line. So the Japanese got a couple of boats here looking to do the best performance they can. And there's a boat that just overstood coming into that bottom mark. The Danish team is Schmidt and Schmidt. And then the British sailing team coming in.
Brickwood and Aldrich coming in at the back of the fleet.
Wow.
And one boat left to cross the line from Russia. There they are, long, long way back.